This demonstration will cover how to complete and submit the Notice of IDR Initiation web form. Initiating parties can start the federal IDR process within 4 business days after the end of the 30 business day open negotiation period if an agreement is not reached between the disputing parties, unless the dispute qualifies for an exception. For the demonstration today, we are going to look at the Notice of IDR Initiation web form in a test environment. All of the data that you see being entered on this form is made up test data. As you can see on the welcome page, there are a few notes and reminders that the initiating parties will want to review, including some general information about the overall process and instructions to completing the web form. There is a section that lists all of the information you will need to provide and use to fill out this form. If you have any questions, you can reach out to the IDR Questions mailbox at federalidrquestions@cms.hhs.gov. There is also a reminder here letting you know that you must complete the form in a single session and that your session will time out after 60 minutes of inactivity. After reviewing the information at the top of this page, the initiating party should read this warning message and the security and privacy agreement. At the bottom of this page, select the checkbox next to the security and privacy agreement and select continue. The following qualification questions pages will ask a series of questions to confirm your eligibility for the federal IDR process. All required fields are marked with an asterisk. If you are completing the form as a third-party administrator, you will need to indicate which party you are working on behalf of. For additional guidance, there is a glossary of insurance terms and definitions that is linked at the top of the form. The first qualification question asks if the service in question was provided prior to January 1st of 2022. Select the radio button next to Yes or No. If the plan renewal date is after the date of service, the dispute will not be eligible for the federal IDR process. I will select No and continue to the next question, where I will select the party type I am or am acting on behalf of. I will select that I am a healthcare provider and enter either a tax ID or national provider identifier number. From the dropdown, I will select the health plan type. Depending on the health plan type selected, there may be additional follow-up questions that require completion. For the purpose of the demo, I will select non-federal governmental plan. Before moving forward, ensure that all required fields marked with the red asterisk are completed and select continue at the bottom of the page. If any of the required fields are not completed, you will get an error when you try to continue to the next page. The next qualification question asks when the open negotiation period started. Either enter the date or use the calendar to select the day that the open negotiation started. The 30 business day open negotiation period must elapse before starting the federal IDR process. At least one file must be uploaded as evidence of the open negotiation period start date. Select Upload Files to choose files or drag and drop files into this area here. However, if the date entered is more than 34 business days prior to the current date, you will need to upload evidence of the open negotiation period start date, and you will be prompted to select an extension justification. If the first reason is selected, you will be prompted to upload evidence of the extension approval. If the second reason is selected, you will be prompted to enter the dispute reference number that triggered the cooling off period and upload evidence of the payment determinations that initiated the cooling off period. For the purpose of this demonstration, I will indicate that the open negotiation period did start within the standard window. Next, Indicate whether the healthcare provider or healthcare facility received consent from the participant, beneficiary, or enrollee to waive surprise billing protections. If surprise billing protections were waived, the dispute will not be eligible. I will select No, then select Continue. The next qualification question asks what you are disputing today. You may select a single dispute, which means I'm disputing either A, one service code that represents one item or service, or B, one service code that represents multiple items or services. Or you may select a batch dispute, which means I am disputing multiple items or services, all of which are related to the treatment of a similar condition. When selecting a single dispute, a secondary question appears regarding whether you are disputing a bundled payment arrangement where there are multiple items or services billed or reimbursed under one service code. When selecting a batch dispute, a modal will appear with a list of criteria that will help determine if the disputes qualify for the batching process. Select Yes or No to make your selection. For the purpose of the demonstration, I will select a batch dispute, review the criteria, and select Yes. On this page, you will be entering information for both the initiating and non-initiating parties involved in the dispute. The initiating party information will be entered first. Note that this section will vary depending on who the initiating party is completing the form as. Because I am completing this form as a healthcare provider, as you can see here, I will enter test contact information for the healthcare provider name, the hospital healthcare facility or group name, mailing address, city, state, zip code, email, and a phone number. Information for an alternative primary point of contact, such as a third-party administrator, can be entered into this section, as well as the information of an optional secondary point of contact. Scrolling down, I will now enter the contact information of the non-initiating party. I will select Group Health Plan as the insurance provider type and enter the health insurance or company name, mailing address, city, state, zip code, email, and phone number. And again, there is the option to provide different primary and secondary points of contact. Ensure that all required fields marked with the red asterisk are completed and select Continue at the bottom of the page. Next, in the Notice of IDR Initiation form, you are going to provide information on the items or services included in the dispute. Enter a claim number and date of qualified item or service. Note that the form will verify that the date entered for each dispute line item is prior to the open negotiation start date provided at the beginning of the web form. If the entered date is after the open negotiation date, this error message will appear. In the payment information section, enter a description of the item or service and what the qualifying payment amount was. Next, at least one file must be uploaded as documentation of the claim in QPA. Select Upload Files to choose a file or drag and drop files into this area here. Also enter the cost sharing amount and what the initial payment was, if applicable. In the Type of Qualified Item or Service section, indicate the item or service type by selecting the checkbox next to the relevant option and enter the service code. Optionally, enter one or more service code modifiers if applicable. Service code modifiers must be 2 alphanumeric characters, and up to 4 separate service code modifiers can be entered. When more than one service code modifier is entered, the modifiers will automatically be separated by a semicolon, as you can see here. Then enter the place of service code and select the location of service from the drop-down list. If the service was in a state with state-specific eligibility criteria, further screening for dispute eligibility is required. An attestation statement will appear where you must select the checkbox to attest that you have reviewed the state-specific criteria and attest the item or service is eligible for the federal IDR process. And before continuing, this is a reminder that you will not be able to submit duplicate dispute line items with the same claim number, date of service, service code, and if applicable, service code modifiers as another previously entered dispute line item, except for in the following situations. First, if the previously submitted dispute was subject to the cooling off period and was closed as ineligible due to submission prior to the end of the cooling off period, or if the newly submitted dispute received approval for an extension from the federal IDR team. The form will verify if the line item exists in the federal IDR portal and will prevent you from submitting a duplicate line item. To add another item or service to this batch dispute, I will select Save and Add Another. You will be prompted to enter another claim number and date of service. Along with a description, QPA, documentation of the claim and QPA, and cost sharing amount allowed. And again, select the item or service type and enter a service code modifier, place of service code, and location of service. As outlined in the criteria for a batch dispute in this section, the form will also verify that the date of service entered for each item or service is within 30 business days of all items and services in the batch dispute, unless the 90 calendar day cooling off period applies. And if the 90 calendar day cooling off period applies, the items and services in the batch dispute are not subject to the 30 business day date of service requirement. Once you have entered all items or services, select Save. A modal will appear asking if you are ready to submit the form. Select Back to add more items or services, or select Continue to move on to the next page. Select Save and Add Another to continue entering dispute line items. If you need to remove an item or service from the dispute, select Cancel Dispute Line Item. You will be asked to confirm if you want to discard the line item. On the Summary of Qualified Items or Services page, you can review all the dispute line item information entered. Select the item hyperlink to go back and edit the information entered. You can select Add Another Item to add another item or service. And from this table, you also have the option to delete an item by selecting the trash can icon. If you need to add supporting information, you can upload additional documents in this section here. Once I have added all the information needed, select Sign and Submit. From the drop-down list, select the preferred certified IDR entity that you would like to handle this dispute. For this demonstration, I will select this test IDR entity. In the Conflict of Interest Attestation section, first indicate whether the person completing this form is a third-party administrator or other service provider initiating on behalf of the initiating party. Then select the checkbox next to the statement below to attest that you do not have any conflict of interest with the certified IDR entity. Enter the initiating party name and the date field will be automatically populated with the date of submission. Select Submit and you will see the confirmation page that confirms that the web form has been submitted and outlines next steps. It is the responsibility of the initiating party to download and print a copy of the Notice of IDR Initiation web form by selecting the Print PDF button and saving this file for their records. It is also the responsibility of the initiating party to send a copy of this PDF to the non-initiating party on the same day the form is submitted. Both parties will receive confirmation emails from the Federal IDR portal, letting you know that the web form has been submitted and will include further information on the next steps. Once you are ready to exit the form, select the exit button. This concludes the demonstration of the Notice of IDR Initiation web form.